Welcome once again to my channel English Made Easy with Mandeep. And today I have come up once again with the very first chapter of your English textbook Honeydew, and the name of the chapter is The Best Christmas Present in the World. And today we will be discussing the summary of this chapter. I'll be giving you the summary of this chapter, taking up the most important, or you can say the hot spots which are there in the chapter, and we will be discussing that also. So before we study or I start with the summary, you should better know the characters. There are few characters in this story, and you should know who these characters are. Then only it will be easy for you to summarize what I am telling you. So let us begin with the very first character, and that is the narrator. Narrator is the person who is narrating the whole story to you. So this particular story, The Best Christmas Present in the World, is narrated by Michael Morpurgo. Okay, so he is the narrator and he will narrate the whole story to you. Okay, now we come to the characters or the people about which the narrator is going to tell us. The first one is Connie, or you can say Mrs. Jim McPherson. Okay, so the first character is Connie, and she is the wife of Mr. Jim McPherson. And Mr. Jim McPherson is an army man, and he is working with the British Army. He is working with them. And now we come to two more names which are usually, which have been used in the chapter, so you should know about them also. One is Tommy. Tommy is basically like when we nickname someone, or when we call someone without knowing the name of that person, when we just give a name to something or someone. Okay, so it is that particular name, Tommy, and Tommy is the name which is given to the British soldiers. And Fritz is the name which is given to the German soldiers. So the British soldiers used to call the German soldiers Fritz, and the German soldiers used to call the British soldiers as Tommy. Okay, and then there is one address also which is very important, which is a part of this story, therefore I want you to remember this. It is 12 Copper Beeches, Bridport, Dorset. So this is the name, this is the place, Bridport, from where the story actually begins. So you should know about this address also. And then in that address, there is a letter which is there in that address, which plays a very vital role actually, and you will come to know when I will summarize this chapter. So one of the dates which was written on that letter was December 26, 1914. That this date is also very important. Why is this date important? You all must have read about the chronologies and the dates, and you must be knowing that these dates and events, they play a very vital role in our lives. So in the same way, the year 1914, it was the year when the First World War had begun, and so this story revolves around the British Army and the German, and the sentiments of the British and the German army men who were fighting for their country. But through hearts and hearts, they were wanting peace. They weren't wanting war. So when we will read this chapter ahead, then I will let you know how the things happened in the story. So in this story, what happened was, the story began with the narrator, and the narrator begins it saying that he went to a junkyard, means a junk shop, where antique or junk or the material which is of no use to us, it is lying over there. Okay, and even you can go, and if you want, you can purchase it also. So one day the narrator, he went there, and he saw a cupboard, or you can say a drawer. Okay, and it was a table which had drawers, a rolling table with drawers in it. And when he looked at that table, it seemed as if it was burnt. Maybe somebody's house would have caught fire, and this particular, what you call, table must be one of the furnitures of their house, and it got burnt. And so it came there. So the narrator, he just looked at that and he thought that I should have it. So he purchased it. And from where did he purchase? He purchased it from the junk shop, which was at Bridport. I told you this place is very important in this chapter. So he purchased that that table with a drawer, which had a drawer also, from a junk shop at Bridport. So when he brings it to his house, as we always do, like when we bring something, we start searching as to, just scrounging, like what is there in it. Okay, so in the same way, out of curiosity, he thought that, the narrator thought that, let me find out what is there in it. So because that table was burnt, it was not in a good condition, he tried to pull the drawer, but he couldn't. So he used his fist. Okay, so he used this fist part of his hand, and he banged on that drawer, and then he pulled it out with a force. And to his surprise, what did he see when he pulled out that drawer? Inside that drawer was also another drawer. There was a drawer inside a drawer, a very small one. And there was not, it was not a drawer, or you can say it was just a box which was made of tin. It was a tin box. And he was surprised seeing that, what is there? He just wanted to know what is there in that box. So he opened it. When he opened it, he saw that some pages were there, and on those pages there was a cellophane. Okay, there was a, it was sellotaped. That those pages were sellotaped. So he again became more curious as to what is there in it, that somebody has sellotaped it first and then put it in a tin box and again in a drawer. So he thought that something is mysterious about it. So out of curiosity, he thought that I should not open. It is not good. You should not open somebody's secrets. You are not supposed to read out somebody's secrets. So he thought that no, I should. Let me read it. Then he tore that thing and he took out. And then the moment he unfolded that thing, it was all wrinkled. When he unfolded that thing, it was a letter. It was a letter which was written by someone, and the name of that person was Jim McPherson. As I told you, who is Jim McPherson? He's an army man. He's a British army person. He belonged to the British army. He was a British army man. He had written that letter to his wife, Connie. Okay, and Connie, Jim McPherson was his wife. So that man had written this letter to his wife, and in that he had told his wife that definitely I will be coming here, I really miss you, and I will be coming here and we both will celebrate the Christmas together. And so when he just read that letter line by line, and when he was reading between the lines, he saw that that particular man, Jim McPherson, has talked about a beautiful incident when the war was going on, the First World War was going on, and the whole world was divided into two power blocks. So it was that time in the year 1914, and the whole world was divided into two power blocks, and the people were fighting. They were waging war against each other. There was death, there was destruction, there were cries and hues. And it was that time when the British army men and the German army men, they were there on the borders. And he told his wife, he wrote to his wife that I tell you one incident. One day on the eve of Christmas, we were all very sad thinking about our families. We were feeling nostalgic as to how nice it would have been if we would have been with our families. And then all of a sudden, from the other side, they saw that there were white flags being waved. Okay, they were waving the white flags and they were coming towards them. And those were the German people who were coming towards the British. And children, whenever there is war and there are borders, there is a land called no man's land. Okay, which neither belongs to the country which is on the other side nor on this side. Okay, it is a no man's land. It is called no man's land. So those people, those German people, they started waving their flags and they started coming towards the no man's land. And the British, they thought that they are trapping them. There is a trap. And you never know, maybe they are waving the flag, the white flag means the flag of peace. You never know, maybe they start shelling on them. So they became more alert. And then again, they came forward, again waving. And not only one, but then one, two, three, and many came. And then there were smiles on their face. They were smiling. They were in a gay mood. And in a loud voice, they wished the British people on the eve of Christmas. So when the British soldiers, they saw that they were coming and they were wishing them, even they also felt very happy. And even they reverted back in a very beautiful way. They were very happy. There were smiles on their faces. And they wished them Merry Christmas. And it was the eve of Christmas. And so the German soldiers, they called them by saying Tommy. They said Tommy to the British soldiers and they wished them. And they also said that we have snaps with us. Snaps is a beverage. And so they said that we will share it with you. We have sausages, we have snaps. So let us share it. So even the British soldiers, they also shared their eatables with them. They said, we have cakes with us, so let us share it. And the cake was not an ordinary cake. It was sweetened by marzipan. Marzipan is a sweet coating which is there, which we do on the cake in order to ice the cake, in order to make the cake look more beautiful and more sweeter. So they shared their things, their eatables. They laughed, they drank together, they ate together, they danced, they sang the carols. The Christmas carols were sung by the soldiers of both the sides. And the Tommies, all the Tommies and all the Frids were in a gay mood, were very happy. And it did not seem as if they wanted war. They were very happy. And in that happiness, the Germans, they took out a football from their bunkers. They brought a football and they said that let us play a football match. And then all of a sudden, what did the British people and the German people, they do? They removed their jackets and their coat, their blazers or their coats, whatever they were wearing, in order to make the poles. We have poles and in which the goal is made when we are playing football. So they made the poles for the goal with the help of their jackets or with the help of their overcoats. Okay, so they use that in order to make the poles. So now they started playing. They were very happy and they played it. And when the game was over, by the time the game got over, they all had become quite friendly with each other. And so this Jim McPherson, he told the other person, the German people, that my name is Jim McPherson and I'm from Bridport. And Bridport is in Dorset. So the other person, who the Fritz, means the German soldier who was there, who was talking to him, he told that yes, I know about Dorset. And he was speaking English in a very nice way, as if he was an Englishman, although he had never been to England. But he said that I have had my schooling in such a way that I know, I have learned English through my schooling. I've learned this language through my schooling. So I don't have problem conversing with the British people. Now, when even the game was over, and they were exhausted, their breathing got intermingled with each other, and then they realized, they thought in their mind that why are we waging wars? So that German soldier, he said a very beautiful thing. He said that instead of waging war, why don't we wage a match like the one we have done today, the one we have played today, a football match or any other game, any other match. Let the countries play these kind of matches, because when we play these matches, there is no death, there is no destruction. And it is for sure, as we have in the wars, one party is victorious and the other is a failure. He fails, is defeated. But there is a difference. Many women, they become widows. Many children, they are orphaned. They lose their parents. The families, they are destructed. Okay, many people, they shed their lives. There is hue and cry in the world. So why not we have matches like this? Because if we will have such kind of matches, there will be no women who will get widowed. There will be no child who will get orphaned. There will be no destruction. There will be no death. How nice this idea was. And both of them, they agreed to it. Although they were enemy countries. The Germans and the British, they were enemies. They were fighting against each other in the First World War. But still, this was the point on which the British as well as the Germans, they were having the same opinion. They shared the same opinion. So it, children, actually it is given on page number 12 of your book. If you can open your book to page number 12, which is, it is written here in the second stanza. I'll read it out to you. It is written, we agreed about everything and he was my enemy. There never was a Christmas party like it. Now he said that Jim McPherson is writing this letter to his wife Connie, and he's telling that that particular Christmas Eve party was the best, because although we were two enemies who were there at that no man's land, but we enjoyed. We were together, we enjoyed together, we shared our things, we talked to each other, but peacefully, laughingly, joyously, in a joyous mood. And then there is one more on the same page, page number 12. Here it is written, I think this is how we should resolve this war. Now the soldiers, the German soldier is telling this to the British soldier, that this is the way to resolve a war. A football match. No one dies in a football match. No children are orphaned. No wives become widows. So they say, both the teams, I should say, teams means the British and the Germans, they did not want to wage wars. They did not rather like being there away from their families. It was Christmas time when everyone wants to be with his or her family. They want to enjoy together, they want to stay together. But that was the time when they weren't there with their families. Their families were alone in their houses, worried about their men at the war field. And the men at the war field, they were sad, they were not in a good mood because they weren't there with their families. So thinking of all these things, they just shared their view. That was their perspective on which both the teams, they resolved. They agreed that yes, it's better to have a football match and decide who is victorious and who has been defeated. And then there are no deaths, no penalties, no death penalties. And everybody is happy. Then you come to page number 14 of your book. Another very important hotspot is there in your book on page number 14. I'll read it out to you and I'll explain it. I know from all that happened today how much both armies long for peace. We shall be together again soon, I'm sure of it. Now the husband, Jim McPherson, is telling this to his wife, that both the armies, they were together there, and both the armies were thinking of just one thing. They were longing for peace, and peace alone. They were longing for peaceful coexistence. Why fight? Why wage wars? This is what they wanted. So then what happened after reading this letter? The narrator, he folded the letter and he kept it in the same tin box. And he thought that how about going to that lady, Connie Jim McPherson, and giving her this letter back. So again, the narrator, he went to Bridport from where he had taken that particular table. And then he went there to that particular address. The address, I have written it on the blackboard. You can see 12 Copper Beaches, Bridport, Dorset. When he went there and he asked for this address, the people told that that house had been burnt long time back. And then when he asked why, then everybody told them that Mrs. Jim McPherson, who was Connie, she was muddle-headed lady. Muddle-headed means a confused kind of a lady she was. And what she used to think that we should save electricity. So, in order to save electricity, she used to lit candles here and there in the house. So they assumed that maybe because of that candle, the house would have caught fire. And in that fire, the whole house got burnt very badly. And luckily this lady was saved. Otherwise even this lady would have got burnt. That is Coney McPherson. So he asked them where that lady is. So they gave the address of one of the hospitals. He said that she is there. So the narrator, he was told that Mrs. McPherson is at Burlington Nursing Home. So he found that nursing home and he went there. And when he went there and he asked the people in the nursing home about Coney McPherson, they told that yes, we have such a lady at our nursing home. She is here for quite a long time, and she's quite old, and she's on wheelchair now, and she doesn't keep well also. And then one of the nurses, she escorted the narrator to that lady. That is Coney McPherson. And when he went there and gave her that sellotaped letter in a tin box, tears started rolling down her cheeks. She was very happy. And out of happiness, she held the hands of the narrator and she said, "You promised me, Jim, that you would come on Christmas and we'll be celebrating the Christmas together. Because you had promised me you'll be coming. So that's why you have come today. And this is the best Christmas present I have ever had in my life." And she was very happy. She held the hand of the narrator in her hand. And she was very pleased to see that person with that sellotaped letter. Now you come to page number 16 of your book. It is written, "I sat down beside her and she kissed my cheek. I read your letter so often, Jim, every day. I wanted to hear your voice in my head. It always made me feel you were with me. And now you are. Now you are back. You can read it to me yourself. Would you do that for me, Jim, dear? I just want to hear your voice again. I would love that so much. And then perhaps we'll have some tea." That lady wasn't knowing that he wasn't Jim. And as I have told you earlier also, that she was a muddle-headed lady, always confused. So she confused him, the narrator, for Jim, her husband, Jim McPherson. And that's why she insisted him that he should read out that letter to her, in which he had written the whole story about that football match, about Fritz, about Tommy and all that, how they enjoyed. So she insisted the narrator that you better read that out and then we'll have tea. And I have also made the chocolate cake for you with extra marzipan on it. Means that sugar coating on it, which was really loved and liked and relished by her husband, Jim McPherson. And this is how the story comes to an end. So students, this story very beautifully tells us a very important thing. What we people are doing these days. We are waging wars, we are fighting, we are competing with each other unnecessarily. one country is making 10 nuclear bombs and the other country wants to make more than 10. But without thinking where we are leading ourselves to. Without thinking that this is not it. Without thinking that this whole world is one family, one big family. And in a family, we live peacefully in coexistence. We do not wage wars. We do not fight like this. Even if we fight, as it has been told in the story, even if we fight, we can fight in such a way where there are no casualties. Like a football match. How beautifully the narrator has told us, given us a beautiful moral that we should always try to live in peaceful coexistence as one big family. The world is a big family and all the members of the family, that is all the countries of the world, should all be together without waging war against each other. So as you all can see on the board, the moral of the story is war always leads to death and destruction, and the world today must resolve to peaceful coexistence. So this is the moral of the story. Thank you.